Hey students, in our last lectures of business research methods, we have discussed about sampling. We have also discussed about error in business research. We have also discussed how to reduce error in research. In sampling, we have discussed that broadly the sampling techniques can be divided into two categories, probability sampling and non-probability sampling. In this lecture, we will discuss further classes of sampling techniques. So as the diagram shows, that sampling can be divided into probability sampling and non-probability sampling. Probability sampling can be further divided into simple random sampling, stratified sampling, systematic sampling, cluster sampling, and multi-stage area sampling. Non-probability sampling can be further divided into convenience sampling, judgment or purposive sampling, quota sampling, and snowball sampling. We'll discuss different categories one by one. So first we'll discuss probability sampling. So first category of probability sampling is simple random sampling. This is the most basic and most important and useful form of probability sampling. This is one of the best way to collect data that has that is a part of probability sampling, and this is used by the researchers. But proper simple random sampling is quite difficult if the sample size is quite large or population size is quite large. So simple random sampling is the procedure that ensures each element in the population will have an equal chance of being included in the sample. So as it is the best type of probability sampling, so each element in the population has an equal chance of being included in the sample. Means if there are 1000 persons or individuals in the population, then each individual will have the equal chance, that is 1/1000 probability of being selected as a sample. So there are no bias, no confusion, no errors if this sampling is used properly. So when it is used properly, I say theoretically there will be no error, but as we know that whatever is theoretical, that is not always possible practically. So some errors are always there, but if it could be implemented properly, so a simple random sampling would reduce the chances of random sampling error. So how it is done in a simple case, we can just explain that if there is a small population, say a population of 100 elements. So what we can do, that we write the name of all those 100 elements on similar type of sheets, put all those sheets in a jar, shake well, and then pick one, and that is our sample. So if the population size is 100 and we want to select or choose 20 samples, then every time we repeat the process, we shake the jar properly and we pick one chit. Again we shake the jar properly and again we pick one chit. So this way we pick 20 chits. So these 20 samples are ideally chosen as the method that is used for choosing this is simple random sampling, because all the 100 elements in the population have the equal 1/100 probability of being chosen as a sample. So if the population consists of large numbers of elements, sample selection is based on tables of random numbers or computer generated random numbers. So if I have discussed that if the population size is small, population elements are 100, 150, 200, then we can go ahead with having chits and doing this. But if population size is large, then we can use a table of random numbers. There are some tables of random numbers that tables of random numbers can be used for, or computer generated random numbers can be used for this simple random sampling. So there is a table of random numbers So we just choose one number randomly from that table of random numbers. Then we can choose, we can go ahead with upward, downward, rightward or left side to choose the next numbers, and those numbers will be the those elements in the population. So we can give numbers to the population and then we can go ahead with the simple random sampling. Second type of probability sampling is stratified sampling. In stratified sampling, the population is first divided into some subgroups or strata, and then samples are selected using simple random sampling from each stratum. So if for a simple example, we can take that if the population is 1000 and there are 50% male and 50% female, and we are going to have a sample size of 100 elements, then what we can do that we divide the population into two subgroups, that is males and females, and then we choose samples from males one stratum and females one stratum. So initially two strata have been defined, and then the samples are chosen on the basis of simple random sampling. Another example of this could be if we go ahead with the, maybe if we want to collect data from again some individuals, then maybe we want to collect data from students. So excuse me, so we can divide the students into different subgroups or strata depending on whether they study in state board, whether they study in CBSE, or whether they study in ICSE. So we have three strata in this case: students studying in state board, students studying in CBSE, students studying in ICSE schools. And then again from these three strata we can choose samples using simple random sampling. Strata are homogeneous within and heterogeneous between strata. So this is very important thing to understand, that these strata are homogeneous within, means one strata consists of state board students. So these students have one thing that is common, that is they belong to schools that are state board schools. Then another strata, CBSE schools. So all the samples or all the elements in this stratum will have one common characteristic, that they belong to those schools which are CBSE, and again another for ICSE students. So these strata are homogeneous within, these strata have all the elements in these stratum or strata have a characteristic that is common, and heterogeneous between. So these characteristics are not common in the elements or people of different subgroups. So one subgroup or one stratum CBSE, another ICSE, another state board. So within that stratum, all the students or all the elements have one characteristic that is common, but between it is not common. That is, they are heterogeneous. Researcher decides the number of samples to be selected from each stratum. So researcher may decide that how many samples from each stratum would be taken out. So for an example, again in our this example, if the total population is 3000, 1000 students study in state board school, another 1000 for CBSE, another 1000 for ICSE. So out of these 3000, if the researcher decides that total 300 sample size would be taken, then the researcher may decide that 100 samples will be taken from each stratum, which is a proportional stratified sampling, because 1000, 1000, 1000, then 100, 100, 100. So it is in the same proportion as the size of population is there. And it could also be disproportional stratified sample, in which if there are 1000, 1000, 1000, but the researcher decides that it would take samples from one stratum, which would be 50, another 50 and another maybe 200. So this is disproportional stratified sampling. So both can be used by a researcher, a proportional stratified sampling or a disproportional stratified sampling. Next type of sampling, which is probability sampling, is systematic sampling. In systematic sampling procedure, a starting point is selected by a random process and then every nth number on the list is selected. So if we have the list of all the individuals, all the elements in the population, then we can choose any first one sample, first one element randomly, then every nth number on the list is selected. Means it could be every fifth, it could be every sixth, it could be every seventh, it could be every tenth. So it is pre-decided that every this number on the list would be selected, but first is selected randomly. So it is again a probability sampling in which the chances are there that every element in the population has chances to be selected as sample, depending on who would be selected, which particular number would be selected as the first sample, then every nth, and it is pre-decided whether it is every fifth or sixth or seventh or tenth, depending on the sample size required. It is decided that every sixth or tenth or fifth or second number would be in the list would be selected for sampling, and this is systematic sampling. Next is cluster sampling. Cluster sampling, the sampling unit is no longer the individual element in the population. We have discussed earlier that a sampling unit and a sample element could be the same and it could be different. So in case of cluster sampling, sampling unit and sampling element are completely different. So a sampling unit is no longer the individual element in the population, but a larger cluster of elements located in proximity to one another. So in this type of sampling, rather than strata, cluster are formed. So if I want to get data from individuals in Kanpur, so I divide Kanpur in different clusters. So depending on the size of Kanpur or depending on the characteristics of different areas, I can divide the whole Kanpur into different clusters. The area sample is the most popular type of cluster sampling, as I have said that the clusters could be formed on the basis of area. So if I want to collect data from Kanpur, I divide Kanpur in different clusters. It is somewhat just opposite to the stratified sampling, as in case of stratified sampling, the strata are homogeneous inside and heterogeneous outside. Cluster sampling, the cluster should be heterogeneous as population itself. So a cluster must have almost all types of, all groups of members that the whole population has. So if I want to collect data from Kanpur, I divide Kanpur into different clusters, into different areas, then that cluster should have the representative from all the subgroups of the population. Means the cluster should have people from as I have taken the example in stratified, we can take the example, similar example in this case as well. So I had taken an example of stratified that when we have three strata, then one is CBSE, one is ICSE and one is state board. In cluster, each cluster would have elements from all the three groups or subgroups. So each cluster would have students from state board, CBSE as well as ICSE. So these are heterogeneous inside, these clusters are heterogeneous inside, and this could be understood easily by this example that if we take the one area as a cluster, then we can never say that that area would have the only students from one particular subgroup. Any area you choose, you would find students from all three subgroups in that area. You would find some students from state board, some students from CBSE, some students from ICSE in any area or any cluster. So it is a heterogeneous cluster. Cluster sampling is classified as a probability sampling technique because of either the random selection of clusters or the random selection of the elements within each cluster. So after making those clusters, within those clusters, the sampling is simple random sampling. So after that cluster, again the sampling done within that cluster is simple random sampling, and when a person is collecting data from one cluster, that would not move to the other cluster. The person collecting data from the other cluster would not move to collect data from another cluster. So data from different clusters would be collected separately. Next and the last for probability sampling is multi-stage area sampling. This is simple to understand, that multi-stage area sampling involves two or more steps that combine some of the probability techniques. So when we use steps of sampling that have techniques used in previously discussed techniques, so more than one techniques are used, that is multi-stage area. Means a simple random sampling and a quota sampling is used, simple random sampling and cluster sampling is used, simple random and stratified sampling is used, simple random and any other is used. So cluster and stratified both are used. So any two or more combination is used, that is called multi-stage area sampling. That is all for this lecture. We'll get back for non-probability sampling in next lecture. Thank you.